Hello, my name's Ken Townsend and I used to work here. Well, some people said I worked here. I was here from 1950 when I joined EMI at Hayes, and I left here at the end of 1995. So it's quite a long stint, really. So I've got quite a bit of experience of what happened to Abbey Road over the years. So if you want to hear some of it, maybe now I might tell you. I went to school at Borlase at Marlow, which is a grammar school, and finished up with loads of A levels. And at that time, because of national service, one never quite knew what you could do next. But I applied for a job at EMI at Hayes as a design and development engineer trainee, and went to in October 1950, and I was accepted and started there on November the 1st, 1950, which incidentally is exactly the same day as George Martin started at EMI. But he started here in Abbey Road at the Frontier, room 41, as assistants to on the parlophone label. Anyway, my time at Hayes was interesting. I started off in test gear department and then did 4 months stints in radio, television, workshops, drawing office, materials application. And finished up for a period in the research laboratories where I was working on design of recording equipment and loudspeakers and various things like that, working with people like Peter Dix and Dr. Dutton. And then sometime in 1954, I was told by Dr. Dutton that they were desperate for two more engineers at Abbey Road. And Dave Frost, who was working with me in the research labs, and myself came up for an interview here at Abbey Road by George Corran. And we were immediately accepted. And so at the end of 1954, I came up here to Abbey Road. Well, when I got to Abbey Road, I was allocated or into the amp room. And the way of working then was different to what it is now, because the technical staff basically were organised all the sessions in the context that what we did was we first of all spoke to the balance engineer, which is now called the recording engineer. Our title was recording engineer, and they were balance engineers. And we first of all discussed with them the layouts for a various session, and we put all the microphones out. We laid out the studio, then we came upstairs and lined up the tape machines, did everything. So all they had to do was come in and lift the faders to start the session. The mixing consoles then, of course, were a bit smaller, a bit more primitive than this one on my left here, which is enormous and fantastic. But there were only a four-way mixer then, only four inputs. And so we were responsible for really the technical side of all the recording sessions. Every session had to have one technical member of staff allocated to it. That was the start of the story. And I say it was a lot more primitive then. There were no pop groups in that time. I think Elvis Presley was just about on the horizon, and we issued those on 78s with Roddy Ridley on HMV label. But my very first session that I remember working on was in Studio One, when there was a bass baritone singer by the name of Peter Dawson, a lovely chap, and he'd been working at EMI right back to the 20s, in actual fact, 1920. He'd worked down at Hayes, and I was introduced to him by Harold Davison, and he shook me by the hand and welcomed me and said, I wish you a long and happy career. And I always remember that, because he was a lovely chap, and he did lots of songs like On the Road to Mandalay and Old Father Thames and that type of thing. And that was the sort of music we were recording at that time. One of the next things I remember too is the Laurie Bamber was the engineer working on an Ambrose session, and he was still insisting on having one microphone. And it was quite a row as went between Norrie Panmure and Ambrose and Laurie about why can't you use a multi-mic technique? But anyway, that's again another story. That was one of the early recollections. Now, when I came to Abbey Road, I was lucky enough to meet and be with quite a few people who had been here from day one when the studios had opened. And if you look at something like, I know that on July the 1st, 1935, the staff numbers at Abbey Road was 36, and that's six part-time cleaners. And that included the van drivers who drove the waxes to Hayes. But we also had 14 staff members who were resident in various countries. We had, for instance, Harold Davison was in Japan, Bob Beckett was in Berlin, Richard Starkman was in Vienna, and Doug Larter was in Stockholm, and Gus Cook was down in Milan. And we had a total of 14 members of staff resident in these various countries, because it was all based from Abbey Road. It wasn't called Abbey Road then, it was called EMI Studios. And in actual fact, it was called the Technical Recording Department, not the studio. So all these people were able to chat, they'd come back, all those were still at Abbey Road when I first came. And a chap called Teddy Holmes, who used to walk around with a little book getting the tape ops to do bandit work and scrapping tapes. And he used to stand there and talk to you for ages about all his times he went to all around the world, this there, to Russia and places. So I've got a fair bit of insight into the story, what happened in those 1930 days. And Len Page told me once that everything was powered from the amplifier room, which I worked in, and there were, Studio One was allocated four moving core microphones, and they worked on a 4.2 volts and 0.8 amps. And number one had four microphones allocated, number two had four microphones, number three had two microphones, and we had a talk studio which only had one. And that talk studio was used before the war for Winston Churchill to make some recordings for speeches. And when he walked in the building, everybody was wearing white coats, and his words were, "My God, I thought I was in a hospital." So times before the war, there was, most of the raw recording was classical. Classical dominated the whole thing in the 30s, with the exception of people like George Formby, who recorded things like When I'm Cleaning Windows. So right up to the start of World War One, it was basically, you know, very similar to what it, nothing much changed really from the day that Edward Elgar opened it on November 12, 1931. But Paul Robeson had been here before that to make a recording, which was Tony LeCantro discovered, and together with the two lads that do the talks, Kevin and Brian. Let's start off with my first impression of when I got here. Everybody in the building was quite nice. It was a bit shabby, not been decorated for years, and a lot of quite old staff here who had been here before the war and really didn't understand much about the technology anymore. They'd been mechanical men, and they were desperate to get younger engineers who were up to speed with the new equipment, with the tape machines. I mean, we were recording on waxes until 1949, and when it was then, the BTR-1 was built at Hayes, BTR standing for British Tape Recorder, which was part of the reparations of the Germans from the wartime when they developed tape machines. And it was a slow transition between going from wax to tape. And we were building the BTR-2, which was the second machine that we had up here, which was absolutely a brilliant tape machine. And that was one of the first tape machines that I was working on. And I recall that just after I arrived, and I hadn't been here when we recorded it, was Abbey Road's first number one was Oh Mine Papa with Eddie Calvert. It was recorded here in 1954 in Studio 2. and it was, the control room was downstairs from where I'm sitting now, and this was a transfer room. And I was, that was the very first number one. The charts are started on the 14th of November 1952, and Here in My Heart by Al Martino was at number one for quite a few weeks, and it was the mostly were American imports at the time that were went to number one. And so Oh My Papa was the very first number one for Abbey Road. There's no jubilation much about it, but it was quite nice to get a number one. The difference between Hayes and Abbey Road was that at Hayes we were on a 37.5-hour week, and we worked a 5-day week. Now, Abbey Road was actually a 39.5-hour week, and we had to work every other Saturday morning to make up that time. So it was on one of these Saturday mornings that I came up, and we recorded Eddie Calvert's second one, Cherry Pink and Apple Blossom White. I think that was the title. I remember vividly about the amount of whiskey he had to drink to blow his trumpet, and Norrie Palmer was there, and his wife Dorothy, and I think Peter Bowne or Stuart Elton, one of the two. I think Peter Bowne was the engineer. But that was the first number one that I worked on. And then soon after, we had a young Irish Colleen called Ruby Murray, who was actually brilliant. So only about, I think, 19 at the time, 18, 19. And she recorded Softly, Softly, which again went to number one. And Peter Baum was the engineer, and he took her to the pictures as well. And and then she had three or four records in the top 10 at that time. And we finished up by we had Alma Cogan did Dreamboat, and then I had to go and do my national service in the Air Force, and because I'd been deferred from national service. And one would assume by then there would have been any, but I was lucky or unlucky in some ways. I had to go in 2 years in the Air Force. And they put me on bomb disposal. They didn't have a recording studio, so I spent my time mostly in a bomb disposal school up in Morton Hall in Lincolnshire, teaching people how to use the mine stuff. And I went down to the Atomic Weapons Research Establishment in Mudderford in Bournemouth to we had a new gradiometer fitted, which we had to drill holes in the ground to detect mines and detect the change in the Earth's magnetic field. Anyway, I was up there for a two-year service before coming back to Abbey Road. But during that time I met my wife, or my future wife, in locally. And I came back down here to Abbey Road in 1958. But funny enough, during the time I was away, they hadn't had a number one hit. But the first record I worked on coming back almost was Side Saddle with Russ Conway. And Stuart and myself had worked on changing the keys on the piano pedal thing. So. Putting some hard gloss thing on to get us hard sounds for Russ Conway. But Side Saddle was the number one. And then from then onwards, it went, you know, there were lots of things. But before I went away, I had worked on a couple of mobile recordings. The first one was The White City to Two in 1955, when I remember we had a van, a mobile recording van, Harry Hands, and Tony Coombs was the engineer. He'd been at He was a recent acquisition to Abbey Road, a youngest chap who had been who played musical instruments in the band in the forces, and we went down to the White City recorded to Two for a couple of days, and I had to crawl underneath the dog track tunnel thing to bring all the cables, bloody filthy it was, and we put four microphones out, moving coil microphones. HB1Es, I think they were, and we recorded it to Two, which was very loud. And Tony went to lunch with Tony Coombs went to lunch with a lot of his mates, and he started missing the afternoon performance, so I had to record it on the van. And there was all the cannons were going off, and Harry Hands was annoyed because I was recording these cannons, but I turned the speakers down. And believe it or not, we used those cannons in the 1812 symphony later on. But that was my first glimpse of mobile recording. And then of course I went on the annual trip to Blackpool to record Reg Dixon, who became a great friend, Reg Dixon, and at the ballroom, at the Tower Ballroom in Blackpool. It was always Stuart Eltham and myself, and from then onwards, Stuart Eltham and myself did a hell of a lot of mobile recordings. And that was my first two mobile recordings before going into the forces. After I came back, my first mobile recording abroad was Fernando Germani in the big church in Zwolle. We recorded Floor Peters in one and Germani in the other. And they were quite hard jobs to do because you had to climb up into the top of these churches to hang microphones. And I went down there with Neville Boiling actually. But when we got there, all the equipment had been shipped out by boat, and it was all covered in green mould. And when I went to start the tape machine, it was all hanging down. The capstan motor was hanging down. I had to repair the whole thing, except one motor I couldn't because the bolts were snapped. So I had this idea. I went out and bought a load of chewing gum, and I chewed chewing gum for about half an hour. And I used all the chewing gum to bolt the capstan motor back on again so we could record it. So that was, I suppose, being a design and development engineer by training, that was sort of something you had to do.